Focal dystonia. Horrible. Your chops are quivering and waving around. You feel like you've lost control. I have one weird technique, weird remedy, weird trick. And this is a good trumpet lesson. Actually, it could be a trombone lesson, depending on what instrument that you're playing, but I happen to be having a trumpet right here. So, why don't we try the Thompson assisted chop buster? And here's how it works. You put the horn up. Maybe your heart starts quivering when it gets here. Okay. You're going to bring your hand underneath when your fingers on the right, on this side here, your thumb on this side here are going to add pressure and stability to the chops. And you can add more to the side. If one side quivers more than the other, you can add more to that. And what you're going to do is hold your chops enough that you can start to get normal tones out. And that should bring in some stabilizing muscles that over a period of time, a shorter period of time, you should start to notice a more steadiness in your tone and chops and watch some of this dystonia dissipate. Say goodbye to dystonia. Okay? Now, this is just one weird technique that I got. If you really want to take care of business, you're going to have to really considerably improve your embouchure strength. And that's not one weird trick or one little tiny remedy. That's a whole process. And when it comes to working with me, that's a 4-month process. So if you really want to take care of business, because you do have that condition, the focal dystonia, where your mouth is quivering all over the place and your lips are quivering and whatnot, you could try this technique I'm giving you right now, because it will work. But it's not a miracle pill, and it's not going to solve all your problems. But it's going to give you that light shining at the end of a tunnel where you look and go, wait a minute, maybe there is something about this, and maybe there is something that can be done to improve my situation. So watch it again. My lips are quivering, you know, when I start playing the middle C. Try it. You'll like it. The lovable and incomparable Pops Clint McLaughlin. I've actually looked at a lot of the stuff on his site, and I'm just like Mystery to Master. I haven't bought all the stuff that he has there, so I've got to remain somewhat neutral on it. So, to answer the question, if all the pop stuff was the holy grail to trumpet and brass playing, then why aren't we all doing it? And I'm like, well, I don't know. It seems like his stuff has the process that one needs to get better. It appears from some of his videos, he has some high caliber players that have taken his courses. I saw a video of Andrea Tolfanelli. Keith Fiala, I saw a video with him taking a lesson from Pops. So, and I guess Keith Fiala says that, hope I'm pronouncing the name right, says that Pops Clint McLaughlin turned around his playing. So obviously, I can't say that it's the holy grail to trumpet playing and brass playing, but it seems to have a lot of merit, and his stuff seems to have a lot of value. I haven't really seen Clint do a lot of playing and be featured on a lot of stuff. So that's one thing that I'm not very stoked about. But yet, people seem to know him and people seem to love him. And he's got a lot of high caliber people talking about his stuff. So I'm going to have to be neutral on this. It could be one of these methods where it could be the Holy Grail too, trumpet and brass playing. But since I haven't bought all the stuff, and there's a lot of stuff to buy there, and so until if and when that day comes where I have hundreds and hundreds and hundreds and start throwing it and buying all that stuff up and going through all of it, I can't really comment and be qualified to say yay or nay. So I'm going to have to be neutral on Clint Pops McLaughlin. But he definitely has a ton of stuff. It seems like for a lot of people, the stuff that he has on there will work and be worthy of your time and money. So that's my story on Clint Pops McLaughlin and his Trumpet College website. And that's Kirk Thompson. I'm out for tonight.
Hi, I'm Kirk Thompson, and welcome to my channel. That's youtube.com/yourbrassinstructor. Thanks for just watching the video that you did. Maybe it's the first one that you've watched, or maybe you've watched tons of my videos. In fact, as of June 2016, as a brass player and trumpet player, I have the most tutorials free on the planet. I have over 600 videos on my YouTube channel currently, all free. So again, thanks again for watching this video. I hope that you got something out of it. Sometimes I make a video just to make you laugh. A lot of times I make a video to educate you on something and maybe even help solve a problem. So I hope something like that occurred for you in this video. And while you're at it, again, subscribe, click on my website link, and go on to the next video. It's lovely out here. Have a great day.
Hey, I'm Kirk Thompson, and I'm here to give a little bit more in-depth tutorial on the most difficult technique on the trumpet, which is the four-octave glissando. Bar none, it's the most difficult. I don't care who you are, where you live, and how good a player you are. The four-octave glissando is the most difficult technique to execute. That said, this does not take quite a lot of talent, folks. This takes brute strength, power, and chops. And that actually means something good for just about everybody. We all have varying levels of talent that we were born with, and that we've cultivated. But this particular technique, even though it is the most difficult to perform on trumpet and certainly any other brass instrument, can be developed. You can make yourself stronger. Yeah, so it's not a matter of how talented you are. It's a matter of going through the process. And for most people, they don't know what that process is. You have to go through the process in order to gain this type of enormous strength and power and being so resilient to be able to go four octaves and power off the way I'm going to be demonstrating in these videos. Now, I have a pretty fun video that I've had out for about 8 years, rocketing up to the double C with the four-octave glissando, but that doesn't really resonate with a lot of people because they can't play double C anyway, much less do the four-octave glissando to it. So, I decided to go ahead and record some four-octave glissandos that were lower. So the lowest one that I got is D, going to high D. I also threw in an E flat or an E and an F. I believe also double high F sharp. And then finally the last note in upper register for trumpet, which is a double high G. And just for giggles, I threw in a four octave glissando going to double high A, and also double high B flat. So somewhere in there, you can start working. Now, the thing about it is, you're not going to be arriving to the land of milk and honey as far as range and endurance just by working this one technique only. In fact, if you've even looked at my website, trumpetsizzle.com, you'll see right there in big red letters, 75 techniques, upper register program. This is one of them. This is one of them. Four octave glissando is one of them. It's the most difficult. But think about it. If this was the only technique that anybody ever needed to reach the stratosphere on trumpet, well, then I would have a program with just one technique, the four octave glissando. And that should tell you that increasing your range, flexibility, endurance is not a matter of a quick tip or trick or something that I can say, here, just try this for a little bit and you're going to be playing like Maurice Andre or Maynard Ferguson. No, it's a process that you have to go through. It's going to take time. You got to have the right roadmap. You got to have someone that can actually show you and demonstrate what you want to accomplish. Not some teacher that's just telling you what they think they know, but they can't demonstrate it. You need to go through the process with somebody that actually can walk the walk. Not just talk the talk, walk the walk. If you've made that decision for yourself, and you actually want to do something and change the way you play for the better. And let's face it, any kind of brass instrument is a physical instrument. It's a physical instrument, no matter what anybody else tells you. Why don't you practice music? You know, why do you spend your time working on range? Why do you spend your time working on your sound? Why do you spend your time double-tonguing? Well, the thing is, this instrument doesn't come with all the notes that you have on a piano. A three-year-old can take their little tiny finger and play the highest note on a piano. We cannot do that on this instrument. We have to spend time on the physical part in order for us to actually make music. You spend all your time just making music without working on the physical part, you won't be sounding too good on that music at all. So I hope this made sense to you. Enjoy the tutorials, and what the heck, go ahead and get your horn out and try one or two. Why not? It's not meant to just watch and put your feet up on your recliner. Get out this guy and start working it. I'll see you in the next one. Try the four octave glissando on a starting on a double pedal E flat up to high E flat. Double pedal E up to E above high C. The four octave glissando from double pedal F up to F above high C. Okay, we're going to try the four octave glissando from pedal F sharp, which is the lowest tier 2 pedal tone that we can get, which is pedal F sharp, before we go into the third tier, which is where I was before when I was on the lower high notes. So pedal F sharp to double high F sharp. Four octave glissando on the last note in upper register before you cross over to into extreme upper register. So that will be going to a double high G, a pedal G to a double high G. we're going to try the four octave glissando on pedal A, rocketing up to double high A. So now we're out of upper register, we're a little bit into the extreme upper register. Hey, you can do the four octave glissando from a pedal B flat up to a double high B flat. Can you do this? Can you do that? Does it matter if you can? Is it a trick? How about? That's gonna get harder going higher, but. No, that was a lot harder. Okay. This is mainly just for giggles, but there is something to it. Try it. What about if you had an octave higher? This is going to be almost impossible. That's like going up a mountain with an 800-pound girl on your back, folks. And I'm not going to try the octave after that, you know, no way. But anyway, kind of suggests something, doesn't it, about the ease of vibration of your lips in the set and placement of your chops. I wouldn't recommend doing much of that, but you know, once a week or twice a week, you could certainly do what I just did here, and you actually fiddle in your lips. I mean, I'm kind of feel like the muscle just kind of got pumped up from doing that. So without the buzzing. There's a real vibrancy to the tongue. I think my low C is sounding better today than my middle C, and that's usually not the case. So anyway, try it. Think outside the box, ladies and gentlemen. So you're navigating from a pure free lip buzz to immediate transition and tone on your horn back to the lip buzz. Low C. Go up to middle C. Can you do it? Back and forth. They're both squirrely one, of course, I see. I mean, even I wasn't, didn't have the continuity as much as I would have liked, but it's just kind of wacky after you get above the staff. I think some other dynamics are at play, you know, with the compression of the air and also the pressure of the mouthpiece and things like that. Hope you enjoyed that little bit of fun. Catch you in the next one. Hey. I'm Kurt Thompson, and I'm a trumpet player that can play a triple C. Do I really need all that range? No. What am I doing here in the gym? I'm about ready to lift 275 pounds. Do I really need to be able to lift 275 pounds to play trumpet? No. But I'm going to tell you my philosophy as soon as I get done. Because it's better to have and not need. Bill Adam, the guru trumpet professor at Indiana, up in Bloomington, IU, and I actually had fun playing with some of his students quite a long time ago on some professional gigs. And these guys were good players. One thing that I noticed about all the Adam students is they had these huge, big sound and lots of endurance and, you know, good to way above average range. And he's known for a lot of his lead pipe buzzing and things that go along with that. So are we going to say that Bill Adam and his lead pipe buzzing routines are the holy grail to trumpet playing? And that if it is, how come we all aren't doing it? Well, I don't think it's the holy grail. But I think that so many people have been helped by his teaching and his pedagogy. And so more than the average routine. So there are a ton of people that got really, really good under Bill Adams' tutelage up in Indiana that you can't say that it's just a fluke or anything like that. He is a good teacher. His stuff is the real deal, has merit and value. And I kind of have to remain a little bit neutral because I never took from him personally. And I've only gone through some of his lead pipe buzzing and some of his routine. I guess the only negative I would have to say, it seems like it gets a little bit tedious, a little bit monotonous. I mean, to hold out, you know, to play 12 lead pipe buzzing E's or F's on your horn for as long as you can with rest. I mean, just that warm up alone, it's about 20 to 30 minutes before you get into this other stuff. So, anyway, if you get a hold of some of Bill Adams' stuff, I would, you know, highly recommend it. I even use some of Bill Adams' lead pipe buzzing in my 16-week upper register course. It's not a weighted or a big deal in my course, but I do like the lead pipe buzzing, so I did use some of it myself. I feel like it opens up my sound, warms me up, and it does. There is something to it. So, I mean, if you played an E in the horn, one or two E or an F, or you played it without the tuning slide in, there's a different feeling that happens on your chops when you don't have the tuning slide in. So there's no question about that. So anyway, this was about Bill Adam and his lead pipe buzzing routines. And can't really say too much bad about the guy. He's put out so many great players. But I don't consider that to be the Holy Grail, his method to be the Holy Grail. If it was, then we would all flock to his former pupils, and we would all just do Bill Adams stuff only. So I feel like that is not the Holy Grail to trumpet playing, but it might be doggone close. Kurt Thompson, that's my story. Sticking to it, baby.
Hi, I'm Kurt Thompson, and welcome to my channel. That's youtube.com/yourbrassinstructor. Thanks for just watching the video that you did. Maybe it's the first one that you've watched, or maybe you've watched tons of my videos. In fact, as of June 2016, as a brass player and trumpet player, I have the most tutorials free on the planet. I have over 600 videos on my YouTube channel currently, all free. So again, thanks again for watching this video. I hope that you got something out of it. Sometimes I make a video just to make you laugh. A lot of times I make a video to educate you on something and maybe even help solve a problem. So I hope something like that occurred for you in this video. And while you're at it, again, subscribe, click on my website link, and go on to the next video. It's lovely out here. Have a great day.
Charles Colin, Advanced Lip Flexibilities, Volume 1, 2, and 3. That entire book was the Holy Grail to trumpet playing. Then why aren't we all doing it? Well, ladies and gentlemen, most of us are doing it or have done it. So I'm going to put it up there as the Holy Grail to trumpet playing. It doesn't really have the complete process, but by God, my money is on the person that went from page 1 to the third study where they're literally up to double A's. My money's on that person. At least range, endurance, and flexibility, and probably sound. So you can't go through that book and do it successfully and not come out a really decently strong player. You know, add Arbenz and some Clark to that, and you got a player that's all around that can pretty much do just about anything on this guy here. So, and just a little side note, I'm self-taught when it comes to lead trumpet, when it comes to the Maynard Ferguson style, when it comes to high range of my horn. There were no high range methods, except for the ones we've already talked about, like the Claude Gordon, but there was no high range teachers and high note teachers, and, you know, strong embouchure teachers where I was when I was growing up. And so I had to figure out this stuff by myself and do it on myself. I didn't have someone holding my hand. There was no 16-week upper register course I could take. Would have loved to have taken my own course back when I was a kid. It wasn't available. However, my first big attempt to try to improve my upper register was through Dr. Charles Colin's Advanced Lip Flexibilities for Trumpet. And I started working on that book and got out of the lip slurs in the volume 1, got into the volume 2 where you really start doing your lip trills on E and keep working your way up. And I seriously worked on that book and got up to about 45 minutes a day. And from marching band and marching band camp in August before my junior year, all the way through the school year, coming around to the very end of my junior year, I had taken my high C, high D range playable, because I was able to play that in marching band. I had taken that and bumped it up a minor third. So I actually had a pretty strong F above high C at the end of my junior year, just from doing the Dr. Charles Cullen Advanced Lip Flexibilities. It's a big red book with white lettering. And so yes, I would say we have to say that is the Holy Grail to trumpet playing, one of the Holy Grails, because everybody seems to be doing it. It works for everybody. I even have some of that stuff in my 16-week upper register course because it works. You can't go through that and put the pedal to the metal and work it and fall flat on your face. It's going to do something for you. You are going to benefit. Your tone's going to improve. Your flexibility is going to improve. You're going to be able to get around the horn better. You're going to have better endurance. Your range is going to go up. It is the Holy Grail for brass playing and for trumpet playing and specifically. So, Colon Advanced Lip Flexibilities. That's my story, baby. Sticking to it.
Hi, I'm Kurt Thompson, and welcome to my channel. That's youtube.com/yourbrassinstructor. Thanks for just watching the video that you did. Maybe it's the first one that you've watched, or maybe you've watched tons of my videos. In fact, as of June 2016, as a brass player and trumpet player, I have the most tutorials free on the planet. I have over 600 videos on my YouTube channel currently, all free. So again, thanks again for watching this video. I hope that you got something out of it. Sometimes I make a video just to make you laugh. A lot of times I make a video to educate you on something and maybe even help solve a problem. So I hope something like that occurred for you in this video. And while you're at it, again, subscribe, click on my website link, and go on to the next video. It's lovely out here. Have a great day.
So if Roger Spalding's 37 weeks to double high C were the Holy Grail to trumpet playing and the brass playing, why aren't we all doing it? Well, the fact of the matter is, I think several of us have done that. It's attractive. Just thought of it, 37 weeks to double high C. If you look at Claude Gord, it's 52 weeks. So you're thinking, well, 37 weeks, not horrible. The basic premise behind Roger Spalding's method and routine is kind of a bodybuilding or powerlifting approach where you practice hard, you have hard and light days, you're kind of practicing every other day, that kind of thing. And so that there's some worthiness to that, there's some value to that. In fact, there's a little bit of Roger Spalding's 37 weeks to double high C essence in the 16-week upper register course that I run, but essence only. So there is something to that. When you work yourself hard with a lot of intensity, it doesn't make a lot of sense to wake up the next morning, get up and work yourself hard with a lot of intensity. And then you go to bed and you get up and you do it all over again. No, if you're trying to build technique and style and some other things, yeah, that's probably going to work. If you're trying to build super endurance and range on top of what you already have, that's not going to work. There's no power lifter in the world that works out 7 days a week in the gym, constantly trying to pull up 700 pounds in a deadlift or bench press 500 and some odd pounds. No, it doesn't work that way. You have to give yourself recuperation. So I like the fact that there's 37 weeks to double high C as this recuperation kind of bodybuilding powerlifting built into the program. The reason it's not a holy grail to upper register and endurance, it has just this one approach. You're hitting yourself from this one angle. You know, you're not hitting yourself from this angle, from the Stevens, right? You're not hitting yourself from the different pivots of the Reinhardt. And you're not hitting yourself from the Adams lead pipe. I mean, all these other routines, you're hitting your chops and tongue arch and throat and everything from all these different angles. So I can't tell you that the 37 weeks to double high C by Roger Spaulding is the holy grail to improving endurance and range, but a lot of us have tried it, just the allure by the name, 37 weeks to double high C. For me, it's not that attractive now, but when I could only play a high D or high E, that was really attractive. When I couldn't even squeak out the note. Are some of you out there at the point where you can't even squeak out a double C? Not even squeak? I'm not saying a usable note. You can't pick up the horn and go... squeak it out. There was a point a long time ago, boys and girls, I couldn't even do that. And it killed me that I couldn't get the double high C to squeak. Forget about using it as a real note like Maynard Ferguson would or Maurice Andre would. I couldn't even squeak it out. So when I saw that book, I was attracted to it. I was like, wait a minute. Just let me do this 37 weeks of double high C. Let me just squeak that puppy out a little bit. I want to squeak it out. I just want to hear it come out of the bell of my horn. Even if it's not going to be a usable note anywhere, I just want to, can I do it? I want to hear it. I've heard Maynard do it. I just want to be able to do it for myself. And so the lure is there with Roger Spaulding's 37 weeks of double high C. It may work for you. It works for more than just a few. It doesn't work for everybody, but it's going to work for more than just a handful. So there's something to Roger Spaulding's 37 weeks to double high C. But it is not the holy grail for trumpet playing and range and endurance. But it's worthy. Kirk Thompson. This is my story, baby. I'm sticking to it.
Hi, I'm Kirk Thompson and welcome to my channel. That's youtube.com/yourbrassinstructor. Thanks for just watching the video that you did. Maybe it's the first one that you've watched, or maybe you've watched tons of my videos. In fact, as of June 2016, as a brass player and trumpet player, I have the most tutorials free on the planet. I have over 600 videos on my YouTube channel currently, all free. So again, thanks again for watching this video. I hope that you got something out of it. Sometimes I make a video just to make you laugh. A lot of times I make a video to educate you on something and maybe even help solve a problem. So I hope something like that occurred for you in this video. And while you're at it, again, subscribe, click on my website link, and go on to the next video. It's lovely out here. Have a great day.
So, if Arnold Jacobs' methods and teachings were the holy grail to brass playing, then why aren't we all doing it? I think the fact of the matter is a lot of us are. What's difficult about Arnold Jacobs? I mean, do you know who this guy is? Not the mouthpiece, the guy, Arnold Jacobs. I mean, dude was... he was like the principal tuba player with the Chicago Symphony for like 40 freaking years. I mean, dude was amazing. I mean, you play tuba in the Chicago Symphony, you know something about chops, you know something about air, everything else, articulation and style. I mean, dude was awesome. Problem I have with Arnold Jacobs is there's not a lot of written material in regards to his routine, his pedagogy, There's some, yeah. I mean, what's that thing, song and wind, or wind and song? I'm sorry if I'm kind of screwing that up. And he's got maybe a book or two up, but there's not a whole lot that he put out in writing. I think a lot of his stuff was just actual teaching, live one-on-one teaching, or maybe even master classes and stuff like that. So it's not like you're going to run into a lot of stuff. Like Herbert L. Clark put out a lot of printed material, from his cornet solos to characteristic studies, elementary studies, and technical studies. But no, Arnold Jacobs, I think his stuff is worthy, especially when it comes to. I've even quoted him on some of the lip buzzing stuff. He really believed in lip strength and embouchure strength. I think he even does some demonstrations with lip buzzing. He believed in certain, I believe he believed in certain apparatus devices that would help your breathing. I mean, my God, the guy was playing a huge contrabass tuba in the Chicago Symphony. He had to know something about air, something about breathing the right way. So, Arnold Jacobs, he's worthy of anything you can find on him. Go get it and look at it. He was playing on this huge bathtub of mouthpiece for 40 years with the Chicago Symphony. The guy is just amazing. As far as being the holy grail to brass and trumpet playing, I probably wouldn't say that, but I would say he's up there. Many of us have actually looked at his stuff. Many of us have applied some of his teachings and concepts to our own playing. So Arnold Jacobs really is a guy that you should not dismiss. You should be investigating and buying some of his stuff and going through it if you're at all serious about playing a brass instrument. So this is Kurt Thompson in regards to Arnold Jacobs, former tuba player for 40 years, 4 decades with the Chicago Symphony. Amazing. That's my story, baby. Sticking to it.
Hi, I'm Kurt Thompson, and welcome to my channel. That's youtube.com/yourbrassinstructor. Thanks for just watching the video that you did. Maybe it's the first one that you've watched, or maybe you've watched tons of my videos. In fact, as of June 2016, as a brass player and trumpet player, I have the most tutorials free on the planet. I have over 600 videos on my YouTube channel currently, all free. So again, thanks again for watching this video. I hope that you got something out of it. Sometimes I make a video just to make you laugh. A lot of times I make a video to educate you on something and maybe even help solve a problem. So I hope something like that occurred for you in this video. And while you're at it, again, subscribe, click on my website link, and go on to the next video. It's lovely out here. Have a great day.
Maurice André. Wow. He revived the whole Baroque trumpet and concerto and piccolo stuff way back in the late 50s, didn't he? I mean, it was dead as a doornail until Maurice André arrived on the scene and pumped it all up. And wow, talk about a guy with chops, one of the up there with Maynard Ferguson as being one of the best ultra talented mega brass players. I mean, can you find too many people to beat Maurice André? I don't even know if I would say Maynard would beat Maurice André. I mean, Maurice had ultra talent, ultra technique, amazing range. A lot of people don't know that Maurice André may could tear up double D's and double E's. And if you don't believe me, check out Maurice André's Hot Canary. Wow. I mean, he's up there doing the same stuff as Maynard. It's pretty amazing. And then he had all this technique, so. Classically trained, wouldn't you think that Maurice André would be able to teach his own son how to play this guy? Come on. You would, right? I mean, wouldn't you dream to be Maurice André's son and be like, oh my God, I can get lessons like 24/7? Well, the sad truth of the matter is, Maurice André, and I've done some extensive research, couldn't teach his own son that well and sent him off to a conservatory. to learn how to play this guy. And the name of his son escapes me at the moment. Maybe I'll add it in a comment to this tutorial. So the whole premise of this tutorial is the fact that don't get stars in your eyes about taking from the best players, most ultra-talented players on the planet, thinking that that's going to rub off on you. It won't. It like 100% won't. Now, if you want to take a lesson with one of the best players, most famous, and put that on your resume, you can. If you want to rub elbows and do some back patting and shake hands and feel good kind of starstruck kind of thing, yeah, go ahead and do that. You want to do this? You're going to be doing this. 50, 80, 100, 150, 200, yeah. You're going to be doing that. And are you going to be playing this guy much better? Zero. You're not going to be playing it. You're not going to be playing your instrument better at all by having taken from a celebrity, star, ultra-talented player, simply because they can't teach you. They're going to tell you what they did, and they're going to teach you that way. That's not going to help you at all, because let's face it, for someone like Bruce Andre, I mean, he could have played, like I said about Maynard Ferguson, come to Jesus in whole notes. He could have played low notes out of the Arbenz book, and he still would have arrived at this amazing, talented, incredible player, Bruce Andre. The rest of us, no, it doesn't work that way for the rest of us. I don't even know if I even have a fraction of the talent that Bruce Andre had and embodied. I don't. You know, I have to work at the stuff I get. Bruce Andre could have just practiced out of a book and never taken lessons, and he would have been better than you and me and every other person that you know. I'll tell you this, I like Alan Vizzuti's playing, but I don't think Alan Vizzuti would want to take on Bruce Andre in Bruce Andre's prime. I'll tell you that right now. Who can beat Maurice Andre's sound? Who can beat that? Nobody can beat Maurice Andre's sound. Put his technique and his style and all that stuff. You cannot beat his sound. His sound is from the heavens. And even people like Alan Vizzuti, Wynton Marsalis, Sergei Nakaryakov, they would have to agree that even though they have the technique that might be equal to a Maurice Andre, they're not going to be able to outdo Maurice Andre on his sound and his style. I mean, you can't beat the guy on that. Listen to his recordings, and for people who have heard him live, I mean, you're not going to be able to outdo Maurice Andre when you combine his technique and a style and a sound. It's coming from the heavens. He couldn't teach his own son at all, and he had to ship his son off to a conservatory. Isn't that amazing? The best classical player on the planet, amazing, and he couldn't teach his own son. So that proves it right there, folks. Don't go spend $500 on a couple hours of lessons with a celebrity brass player thinking that you're actually going to get something out of it. You're not. You're going to get starstruck, maybe 15 minutes of fame, a little tickle in your tummy, but you're not going to become better at this. And as I mentioned in the Maynard Ferguson overview with his son Bentley, something creepy and eerie. It just doesn't, it's almost hard to imagine. But Maurice Andre's son also perished in a freak fall of a hike. And whether it was cliff climbing or some kind of weird hike, but he perished in a fall, and so did Maynard Ferguson's son. Creepy and weird. Incredible that two of the greatest brass players that ever walked planet Earth, Maynard Ferguson and Maurice Andre, that both their sons would perish in a freak fall at an early age. It's crazy. It's weird. That kind of caught my attention. I was like, wow, how could that even be? I don't even know if Maynard Ferguson met Maurice Andre. I don't know if they knew each. They probably knew about each other, but I don't know if they ever met each other. So it was really heartbreaking, catastrophic and horrific to find out that I believe it's both of their firstborn sons died in their early 20s in a freak fall. It's horrible to think about. And anyway, so that's my tutorial on Brice Andre. Ultra talented guy. Another explanation why you probably should hold on to some of your money and not throw it at a star trumpet player, trombone player, whoever it is that's famous, and thinking that you're going to get something out of this. You're not. That's my story, baby. I'm sticking to it.
Hi, I'm Kurt Thompson, and welcome to my channel. That's youtube.com/yourbrassinstructor. Thanks for just watching the video that you did. Maybe it's the first one that you've watched, or maybe you've watched tons of my videos. In fact, as of June 2016, as a brass player and trumpet player, I have the most tutorials free on the planet. I have over 600 videos on my YouTube channel currently, all free. So again, thanks again for watching this video. I hope that you got something out of it. Sometimes I make a video just to make you laugh. A lot of times I make a video to educate you on something and maybe even help solve a problem. So I hope something like that occurred for you in this video. And while you're at it, again, subscribe, click on my website link, and go on to the next video. It's lovely out here. Have a great day.
Carmine Caruso. Some people swear by it, and some people swear after doing it. So, it is the Carmine Caruso method, the holy grail to trumpet and brass playing, and without a question, without a doubt, no, it's not. I've had more students come to me with more problems from doing Caruso than just about anything else. The thing about the Caruso method is it does make you extremely strong. So you do get real musculature here, real tough corners of steel and everything else, but at a price, at a loss of responsivity in your lips and a loss of flexibility. So you do gain the strength, but you're not going to really realize the results of that increase in strength because it's going to be offset and diluted by your lack of flexibility, the brittleness, and the lack of response in your lips. You have to be flexible and have very responsive lips to vibrate at those higher frequencies, especially above high C. And if your lips are thick and dull and tight and they're not flexible and they're not vibrating, you're going to have trouble. Now, has the Caruso worked for some players? Yes, it has. So some people swear by it. But those people are so few, so very, very few. So I think other people swear at it. That's why I mentioned that at the beginning. I've done the Caruso many, many years ago, and it really screwed up my playing. I actually had to quit playing for, I think, a week to 10 days, just play baritone and buzz on mouthpieces. And that's how much it screwed me up. So that wouldn't be my go-to method. I believe it has the process in there, but it's the process that takes you down a slippery slope that if you end up like I did, I had to quit playing for a little bit and let everything kind of settle and get back to normal. So that's Carmine Caruso. Some absolutely love it, and it has done wonders for them. But there's the other type of human beings on the planet, like myself and many others, that it actually had an adverse reaction. So Carmine Caruso and Kurt Thompson. Again, that's my story. Sticking to it.
Hi, I'm Kurt Thompson, and welcome to my channel. That's youtube.com/yourbrassinstructor. Thanks for just watching the video that you did. Maybe it's the first one that you've watched, or maybe you've watched tons of my videos. In fact, as of June 2016, as a brass player and trumpet player, I have the most tutorials free on the planet. I have over 600 videos on my YouTube channel currently, all free. So again, thanks again for watching this video. I hope that you got something out of it. Sometimes I make a video just to make you laugh. A lot of times I make a video to educate you on something and maybe even help solve a problem. So I hope something like that occurred for you in this video. And while you're at it, again, subscribe, click on my website link, and go on to the next video. It's lovely out here. Have a great day.
Hey, you won't believe this. One weird trick to solve your dizziness problems. I don't know too many tuba players that get dizzy from blowing high notes. It might, I don't know, could be there. Trombone, maybe more. But basically, it's your lead trumpet players that are playing above high C. They get dizzy. I'm not going to go into the entire medical delineation of why you're getting dizzy and or maybe not, but basically it works like this. You have a certain amount of blood in your body, right? Gravity makes a lot of your blood go down to your lower torso. Now, when you blow hard, you see the veins popping out. What's going on? You're blowing. You're spreading the blood away from your brain and your heart. It's going away. Okay. Now, if you happen to have a lot of blood hanging out in your lower extremity, your feet and your ankles and your thighs and your calves, and all the stars line up right, you will get dizzy. And in fact, if you keep blowing high notes, you're going to pass out. Passing out is not a bad thing because basically the body wants you to go prone. It's your body's way of having you actually pass out to go prone to save yourself, so all the blood can immediately be pumped back to your heart and to your brain. So in case you didn't know why you're getting dizzy, that's what's going on. Now, a lot of factors come into play too. Your age, your weight, your height, chemicals like, do you smoke, drink a ton of caffeine or coffee, Red Bulls and things like that, 4-hour energy, your water intake, how hydrated are you, your stress and your sleep. So these factors all conspire against you and give you that feeling that you want to pass out. In fact, if you don't acknowledge that feeling, you will pass out. So I used to be afflicted by that when I was, well, I guess I, hold, let me go back one more step. Also, if you're playing loudly and for a long period of time near your max range, that will also tend to want to make you pass out. And when I was a younger guy in college, I did notice on some of the lead trumpet charts that I was playing on that were top tier back then when I was 19 and 20, I would kind of like do this thing. Whoa. After I got done, I was like, oh my God, I'm just about ready to pass out. Well, the reason for that was because back then at 19 or 20, I think I had a good double A, double B flat, double B, double C max range. Which is not bad, right? But when you play and butt up against that max range, you're going to probably feel dizzy and pass out because that was my max range and I was playing at it, using the maximum mouthpiece pressure, blowing. And what was going on is the blood from my brain, my heart was being pressed away. And my heart, no matter how good it was, could not pump blood from my feet and my ankles fast enough back up to my heart and my brain, and that's why you get dizzy. Your body really wants you to be forced to go prone. Standing up, prone. So it's not like you're in bad condition, as your body wants you to do that, just saving yourself. So one weird trick that solves this problem. Also, I forgot to mention other factors like heat. I remember I drove from Santa Monica to Fullerton to play at Steamer's Jazz Cafe. It was 93 freaking degrees out. And I was stressed out. Drive took me an hour and a half in crappy LA traffic. Why was I stressed out? I hadn't played in a couple of years. At that caliber. And I got called in to sub the lead chair. And I actually ended up doing pretty good, but it was stressful. I had some anxiety. It was hot. I don't know if I was hydrated enough, but I did take one precaution because he said there would be several Maynard charts on there. So here's the one weird trick, folks. Compression socks, baby. They look like women's nylon hose, right? But these guys are medical grade 30, I believe it's 30 milligrams of compression. When they go on really, really tight. Two of them. On that particular day, just because I knew that I hadn't played, I mean, I'd played in a couple bands before, but it was easy for me. Old-timey white tie, woodchoppers, ball kind of stuff. I don't really count that as for me playing. It was okay playing, but this particular band had a lot of pros in it, and they were going to be playing some really tough charts, and I wanted to go there mainly to be recorded and be able to put those up on my YouTube channel and other sites, and I've done that, and you can see me playing some different stuff on YouTube with that particular group. I think the guy's name was Don Kubik. He's also a friend of mine on Facebook from like 4 or 5 years ago. But he runs a big band in the LA area and made up of mainly working professional LA players. Now, I got called in to play the lead book, baby. Sight read it and nail it down. That's when, the pedal hits the metal, right? And, because of the temperature, because of my stress, anxiety, because of what I knew was coming for me, I wanted to make sure that I could go through the whole book and hopefully my chops would hold up. But if not, I didn't want to pass out. And that's why I was actually wearing these. So that particular day, what I ended up doing is right before I got in the car and got in that hour and a half of traffic from Santa Monica to Steamer's Jazz Cafe in Fullerton, which is Orange County, I got on my bed and I put my legs up on the wall like this. So if you can imagine me, I'm laying down and my heels are hitting the wall like that. And I'm letting all the blood drain back down to my torso. And after about 15 minutes, because due to gravity, that's when I put these guys on. And that's when I dress with my black pants and my attire for playing. So what this does, it grips and is so tight that it does not allow a lot of blood flow back to your lower extremities. It enables your heart to keep pumping blood at a closer rate and a closer distance from where your heart is and where your brain is. And as a result of that, that is the one weird trick, my brass playing friends. Get yourself some compression socks. Now they make all kinds. They make sock. It looks like socks, like ankle socks, socks that go to your calves. These are actually thigh high. So they go up to your mid thigh, and they actually make compression pants that go up to your waist. And I first got turned on to this by ultra marathon and triathlete competitors. Believe it or not, if you see them wearing all black tights when they're running, now that costs a lot more than this, but those are compression tights, and so what that does is it gives them a lot better endurance. Their part is not working so hard to pump blood from their feet back up here, because those compression tights from their ankles all the way up to their waist is forcing the blood to stay more in their mid torso. And so I got turned on to this idea that if that works that way, what would it do for people who have a tendency to pass out? So there's no site out there telling you that this is working for trumpet players and trombone players that are playing extreme high lead stuff and getting dizzy. You heard it here. Let me toot my horn on that one. You heard it here right now. I'm the one that discovered that. It's a quirky idea. It's a quirky, weird tip and trick and technique, but it works. And you know what I'm talking about. If you get dizzy, it's a horrible, impotent feeling, isn't it? Impotent. You got the chops to blaze away on that note, but dang it, you can't because you're going to do this. And that's a very impotent feeling. To know that you got this, and you got this, but you can't do it that much because you're going to go, you're going to fall out. Now, with this one weird trick, and it is weird, baby. Compression hose, compression socks. Get them online, because when I first checked this out, I bought them at CVS. Man, it was like $80 for these. I returned them when I found out I can get them online for about a third. These were about $28. So, yeah, you can go to CVS or Walgreens or Walmart or whatnot, and you're going to pay about, it is expensive. You're going to pay about $70 or $80 for thigh-high 30 milligram compression medical grade socks. Don't do that. Save your bucks. Go online. Order them. The same damn thing. And just wait a little bit, and you're going to save yourself $50. You might as well put that $50 in, buy a nice Trumpet Lesson for me. There you go. Mm-hmm. Yeah, that'd be better use of your money than giving it to Walgreens. You got to give it to starving and low-income teachers, right? You got to give something back. There you go. So try it. If you're a lead trumpet player, or you're just a guy playing around, but you can't have that much fun playing because you're getting dizzy, try this one weird trick and prove me wrong. You won't be able to. This is the real deal. Compression medical grade socks. These are 30 milligrams. They come in all ratings from, I think, as low as 15 milligrams up to 50. I would recommend somewhere in the 25 or 30 milligram range. 50 is for people that have had vein surgery and people that really have a horrible, horrible problem with, let's see if I can remember what the term is. Vasal. No, I'm not going to remember what it is. It's a, dang it. I wish I could remember that name of that term. It's a syncope disease that affects some Americans and some people in the world where they're always getting dizzy. They're not playing trumpet. They're getting dizzy when they stand up, when they go off from bed and they stand up, they're really getting dizzy. And they really do have this medical condition. Oh, I just thought of it. It's vasovagal syncope. Vasovagal syncope. That's when your heart is not able to pump up blood from your lower extremities quick enough and you're getting dizzy all the time. Not because of trumpet or trombone. But for us, we're not concerned about that, and I'm not a medical doctor. It's a weird trick. Go spend $30, $40 on some medical grade compression socks, and you're going to be amazed that when you go out to your gig or your rehearsal, you can blow your brains out and you will not pass out.
Hi, I'm Kurt Thompson, and welcome to my channel. That's youtube.com/yourbrassinstructor. Thanks for just watching the video that you did. Maybe it's the first one that you've watched, or maybe you've watched tons of my videos. In fact, as of June 2016, as a brass player and trumpet player, I have the most tutorials free on the planet. I have over 600 videos on my YouTube channel currently, all free. Again, thanks again for watching this video. I hope that you got something out of it. Sometimes I make a video just to make you laugh. A lot of times I make a video to educate you on something and maybe even help solve a problem. So I hope something like that occurred for you in this video. And while you're at it, again, subscribe, click on my website link, and go on to the next video. It's lovely out here. Have a great day.
I'm a comeback player, and I just completed Kurt Thompson's 16-week upper register and endurance course, and it was really great. But actually, I'm here today to talk to you a little bit about Kurt and his brand new course, the Ultra Comeback Player course. A little background on me: I started playing when I was 9, played through high school, in college, traveled the world playing lead trumpet with a group, and then I made a decision to change direction, went to business school and went into business, and just stopped playing completely. But more recently, I started thinking I might want to get back into it again, and I started looking for a good teacher in the program. I found Kurt, saw some really good endorsements, gave him a call, and started the course. At one point, I shared with Kurt that there must be a lot of guys out there, brass players, who haven't played for a long time. In my case, I haven't played for decades, who are looking for a teacher and structure to get back into playing again. That was the genesis of the Ultra Comeback Player course. So Kurt designed the course. I just looked at the outline. I think it would be perfect for any comeback player, regardless of their goal. In my case, I'd like to be playing back in a rock group, a Latin group, or a jazz band, but a player who's just interested in playing for their own enjoyment, wants to make progress, or they want to join a community orchestra. I think it's the perfect structure to get you back into it in the right way and start feeling confident about yourself and enjoying the whole process. So I highly recommend you give Kurt a call. Check out the course, and good luck to you getting back into playing again.
Register. One reason that you might not be playing so easily in the upper register, and there's just one reason, there's actually a lot, is this guy. Oops. Wait a minute. Uh-oh. What am I doing this? Hello. Tuba mouthpiece. Versus trumpet mouthpiece. Your mouthpiece could be putting up such an awesome fight that you are losing both the battle and the war. You're losing it all. Perfect aligned in-tune efficiency allows you just to soar and soar and soar. It's like a bird hovering on a thermal, or even a plane for that matter. Have you ever watched planes take off when it's cold or when it's warm? Notice when it's really warm, they'll hit that thermal and they'll actually leave the runway a lot quicker and sooner before the end of that runway compared to cold weather. So efficiency comes from many, many different parts of our plane, including the equipment, how we breathe, how we've trained ourselves in the musculature up here, and then the three stages of compression. And there's a lot to talk about when it comes to efficiency on a brass instrument. And just because I'm holding this guy up, don't let that ostracize you if you play on, ooh, oh, yes, ma'am. Yeah. So, don't be fooled. If you play a brass instrument and you play into one of these, this is for all of you. Okay? Now, wait a minute. So, I have a choice to play this mouthpiece. And what if I want to play this mouthpiece? Same difference? Think about it. What if I could actually put this into my horn? No, it's not the same difference. In fact, that's one reason you might be having trouble being inefficient on the horn. What's the word I'm looking for? Ego. Cockiness. Being a stud. How many times have I killed trumpet players who couldn't play high, couldn't play loud, and sounded forced, but guess what? They were like, oh yeah, well, Kurt, you're playing on one of those cheater mouthpieces, and I play on a Bach 1.5C. Yes. Or I play on a Bach 3C, you know? And you're playing on one of those cheater mouthpieces, so. Cockiness. Let that cockiness and ego go down the drain, because it's going to get you nowhere fast. You might feel really good going to bed at night knowing that you played on a Bach 1.25C. Have you played on one of those? They actually have a Bach 1.25C. I used to play one. Because I wanted to feel better about myself. I felt better about myself, but my playing sounded like crap. Okay? So I needed a lot bigger lips than these. Look at my lips. I need lips about twice this size, at least, to do what I can accomplish on this guy. Okay, so this, let me explain mouthpieces. So, first of all, if you're playing on the wrong mouthpiece that's inefficient, what's going to happen is, typically, it's going to be too large for you. You're going to have too much air, slow air, going into the mouthpiece because the bowl is going to be too big. And I'm making an extreme example with this. I could be holding a Bach 1.5C, not a tuba mouthpiece. I'm making an extreme example. But so I'd have too much air going in, slow. That would be one thing. My lips won't be able to really hold the last stage of compression in the aperture because what's going to happen is as they go into a big mouthpiece, they're just naturally going to flap around slower. Sorry. There's nothing to snug them up to. There's no, the bowl is so far down. No, it's almost like I'm lip buzzing. So, if the listen extreme example, of course, folks. So, inefficiency. This would be a very inefficient mouthpiece for me to play on this instrument. Now, possibly, what am I holding here? It's a Yamaha 67. This might be a fantastic mouthpiece for some tuba players to be very, very efficient, maybe. Maybe not. So, one thing that could be holding you back, now I want to let you know, after having taught more than 1,500 individual students, that's no joke, and 300 or 400 of you in the last 7 years have been advanced and professional players, I've learned a little something about what everybody's going through, and at least one thing that we all know is inefficiency in equipment. So if you feel like you're fighting on the horn, Beck, you heard me play what I play at the beginning, right? Themed Ice Castles. So if you can't get up there, now that's an easy thing for me to do, and it should be easy for any pro player to do. Hello? I only went to high F. Nothing fancy, no fancy skips and tongues, and no, this is pretty easy. Now, if you can't get up there and soar like that and just feel good, I felt like the horn was playing itself. You see me playing? I wasn't even hardly breathing. The horn was playing itself, and was it rock? It wasn't marching band or drum corps loud. Was it loud? Yeah, I probably were going to get some calls from the neighbors here in another couple of minutes. I mean, but it was forte. If I was playing that as a solo in a big band, jazz band, or some concert in the park series, you would definitely hear it. And but efficiency, folks, efficiency. You got to get the efficiency and half, I'm not even going to say half the battle, part of the battle, because it just depends. Part of the battle is the equipment. I would say it's kind of a smaller part. This is a smaller part. This is a bigger part. What does that mean? That means I'd rather take my custom Bob Rees mouthpiece and put it into a Bundy trumpet and go to town than to take a stock Bach 7C and put it in a $20,000 Monette trumpet. Why? Because this matters less than this. So if you don't get anything out of this tutorial, invest your money in a good mouthpiece. And I had to invest over $300 in this guy. Why? This is a Bob Reeves 43, la, 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 la. Sorry, 42S, dang it, 42SV, my bad, 42, probably can't even see that, so there's no point even showing you, 42SV, that's like Sam Victor. Okay, this is Bob Reeves. This rim, check it out, see if I can get the... Is there anything left on? Oh, there's a little bit. You're not going to be able to see it. This rim actually came out of this mouthpiece. I had a duplicate. This is a Neil Sanders 17S. Yeah, it's kind of dark in here. Sorry. The way I got it set up, you're just not going to see it. But this is a Neil Sanders 17S. They don't make them anymore. Okay? So what I did is I liked this. I liked the rim. The rim felt good. But... the backboard of this is pretty large to do what I do, and so I really felt that I was being inefficient blowing. Now, when you heard me play at the beginning, I was playing on this one because I built up enough chops to be able to play on just about any mouthpiece that I want, at least for a limited amount of time. Now, I wouldn't want to play this for a four-hour, you know, wedding reception gig, big band, no way. Mm-mm. But anyway, so you heard me playing on this mouthpiece. It's a Neil Sanders 17S, decently shallow. Is it the most shallow mouthpiece in the world? Heck no. And it's wide. This guy's wide. Very wide. That's a wide mouthpiece. It's probably as wide as a Bach 1C. Maybe even slightly wider. But it's shallow. So I like a wide rim. But this wasn't doing the trick for me for everything. And I would get tired on it. In other words, this mouthpiece was somewhat inefficient for me. I spent 3 to 3.5 hours... at Bob Reeves' studio, his new studio in Valencia, am I saying that right? Valencia, California. And that's right across from the Six Flags. And when I used to live in California, I went up to his office, told him what I wanted. What he did was he took this mouthpiece, because remember I had two, and he cut off the rim, put threads on it, and we went to town. And what he did is he brought in tons and tons of these backboards. And he didn't bring in the large ones because I told him I wasn't interested in being, I'm not going to be in an orchestra somewhere. I'm not going to be doing brass quintet. I'm not going to be playing third trumpet in a concert band. I'm going to be doing what I do, and I already told him what I did. And so he threaded this. We started trying all different kinds of backboards, mixing in different sleeves over and over and over again. And it took probably the better part of a 3.5 hours in an afternoon. And I ended up with this. The top is a top rim cut from a Neil Sanders 17S. The rest of it is Bob Reeves, that 42SV. And then this is actually a number two. You know, you can see that. You're probably not going to be able to see that. It's number two. It's a number two sleeve. Now, once I got done with that, my lips are not equal. The bottom lip is quite a bit bigger than the top. I actually went to, where did I go? Was it Home Depot? I think I went to Home Depot and I bought epoxy. Now epoxy comes in two tubes. Epoxy is what you use. You can use it for all kinds of stuff. It's like a well. It's like a not temporary, but it's like a well that you can do yourself. And I fashioned a little thing and put it in the mouthpiece. You can't even see that. And now I'm gonna have to go out and do it again. You can see the indentation in the mouthpiece where it used to be. See that? And so it actually went into the mouthpiece like this. Well, it's not going to be perfect, but there we go. Perfect. Perfectly like that. Wish you could see that. There, can you see that? It's in there. I'm going to have to redo this sucker because when I was like screwing around and screwing the mouthpiece, it came out. So this makes the mouthpiece more efficient for me because my lips are inefficient. They're not equal. This is bigger than this. And when I put my mouthpiece in, I'm not getting the best compression I possibly can And so I think outside the box, baby. And when I think outside the box, I do crazy stuff like this. You can see it. There it is. See it? It's in there. That's epoxy, ladies and gentlemen. And it comes in two little tubes about the size of, well, probably about the size of my index finger, but a little bit thicker than that, a little bit longer, two of them. And what you do is you break them open. It's like Play-Doh. Put them together and you roll them, get them hot. And then you can just start playing around. If your lips are unequal now, like mine, if both of your lips are equal, you don't need to mess around with it. That's why these asymmetrical mouthpieces came into play, because of the inequality, like the wedge mouthpiece and some other ones, because of people's jaw structure and lips. So now I actually put the finishing touches with this on my mouthpiece. And the end result is, for me, extreme efficiency. And I'm telling you, when I'm running on all cylinders like a Lamborghini, I don't care who's playing with me. I'm going to be, especially if I'm playing lead, I'm going to be pouring out some sound, baby, and I can bury any band that I want to if I choose to. And sometimes at the end of a song, you want to bury the band because you want everybody to let that double C or that double A or that double G be dominant. And otherwise, you got to use your calibration and sound good and be a good tasting lead player, if I'm talking lead. So anyway, the purpose of this video was to kind of reveal a little bit more about myself, my way of thinking as far as efficiency.